isolation. Actually, apart from immunology, you can use the lymphocyte isolation, viability test, and cytotoxicity test for various cell biology work, zoology work, and genetics. All disciplines will be using. Lymphocyte, it is a very common protocol. Even cell line, this lymphocyte cell culturing also we can do if you do a proper cell line. It's a lymphocyte isolation. So we'll discuss the normal procedures of lymphocyte isolation with the reagents which are available with us. See, now we'll do the lymphocyte isolation. For this, the items required is blood. Here we have dextran reagent, dextran graded reagent. Instead of that, you can use phycol or you can use even sucrose gradient also. So, but for this particular experiment, we'll be using dextran gradient reagent. So, different molecular weight agents will be there. So, make sure that as you are handling the blood, there should be no cuts. There is a possibility of infection. So, better you wear the gloves whenever you are handling the blood or blood related products. So, you should be thorough with your protocol. And what you are going to do and how you are going to do, you should be thorough. And your protocol book also should be ready, and you should make a note of everything. And you label the tubes, whatever you are using. So this is the blood, which is collected with anticoagulant. You can collect with ADTA or heparin. And this is a phosphate buffer saline. Phosphate buffer containing normal saline in that one of pH 7 we're supposed to use. And here we'll be taking equal volume of phosphate buffer saline and blood. So mix the blood thoroughly and make sure that there is no clumping, there is no clots in it. As I said, equal proportions of blood and PBS should be taken. And you know, pipettes are two types, flow through and end point kind of thing. So this is the end point kind of thing. No, don't drop till the end. Mix it thoroughly, make a uniform suspension. Now we'll be taking the reagent which creates the gradient. Normally in cell biology laboratories they will be using phycol, but here we'll be using dextran gradient reagent, where you'll be having different molecular weight dextrans, 25,000, 40,000, 50,000, different gradients will be there in that one. Here you can use sucrose, 10% sucrose solution you can prepare, and you can, because sucrose is a highly dense one, RBC which are having a high denser, they will be going down and they will be settling down, and plasma as usual, serum or plasma will be there in the top, and your lymphocytes will be there in the central part. So here, without disturbing the dextran suspension, dextran grading reagent, slowly you overlay your samples, your diluted blood sample. See, make a sloping kind of thing. and without much disturbing. Add your diluted blood. Dextran, Ficol is expensive. Dextran reagent is also not that expensive. But with sucrose, you can do in normal, even BSC labs, any routine labs, you can do this thing. And if you have purified lymphocytes in your hand, you can do n number of experiments. Make sure that it is not mixed immediately. So overlay carefully. If there is a gradient, definitely it will not be mixed because the lower portion is denser one. Now make it vertical, erect. Now centrifugation has been completed. You do centrifugation at 3000 G, that is depending upon instrument, almost 3500 to 4000 RPM. You can see here at the base, RBCs have been settled down and the serum or plasma is there in the top portion, and this white buffy coat, this layer is lymphocytes, or majorly other leukocytes are also there in that one. But lymphocytes, their molecular weight size is less than that of other WBCs, so that they are going to be accumulated at the top. So we'll discard the supernatant first carefully. Here, don't dispense. Better you take some pipette or dropper and carefully remove the supernatant and you discard it first. Don't wait till that buffy coat layer, when the serum or plasma is still remaining, you mix that buffy coat or lymphocytes and take along with the serum or plasma. Now you will need to wash the lymphocytes with PBS. So to the isolated suspension, you add the PBS of pH 7 and do the centrifugation. And whatever the serum or plasma has come in earlier stage will be washed out during this washing. Here, the centrifugation, generally cytological centrifugations, you need to do at 3000 G, that is 3500 to 4000 RPM. And here the cells are delicate, keep it in isotonic condition only. That's what PBS will prefer. After the centrifugation, you can see the pellet at the base. See, there is a pellet over there, and there is a small pellet over there because we have collected hardly with 2 ml blood. Now discard the supernatant. Now the pellet is uniform. There is a firm pellet is there. Now you can discard. There is no problem at all. Now suspend whatever the pellet is has been formed. There's a lymphocyte pellet should be suspended. You can add little amount of phosphate buffer. Otherwise, existing you can use. You can take and you can preserve this lymphocyte. Now isolation has been finished. Take little amount of phosphate buffer to resuspend the pellet. So these lymphocytes are ready for our various immunological studies, cytological studies, toxicological studies, different types of studies we can do. So first, what about the lymphocytes we isolated? And we need to check how many of we got lymphocytes, and out of those, whatever the cells we got, how many of them are viable? Viability is very important. How many of them are live or how many of them died? That also we need to measure. So next experiment, we'll see the viability and the count of lymphocytes.
A hemocytometer is a device that is used for counting cells. It's a modified microscope slide containing two identical wells or chambers into which a small volume of cell suspension is pipetted. We have already removed 100 microliters of our cell suspension and placed it in a microcentrifuge tube. Dilute the suspension by adding 100 microliters of Tri-Pan Blue. Tri-Pan Blue is a dye that helps us distinguish between living and dead cells. The dye passes through the membranes of dead cells, so they will appear blue under a microscope. Living cells exclude and will appear mostly clear. Load both chambers by pipetting the suspension under the cover slip. Now place the hemocytometer under the microscope. Each chamber is divided into a grid pattern consisting of 9 large squares. Each square has the same dimensions and contains 10 to the negative 4th power milliliters of suspension. The rules for counting cells sometimes differ from lab to lab. In our lab, we count cells in the 4 large corner squares and the center square. Let's count the cells in the first square. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So what about the cells that are touching the outside boundaries of the square? In our lab, we count the cells that touch the top and left boundaries, and we ignore the cells that touch the right and bottom boundaries. 9, 10. We need to count the number of both living and dead cells. Remember, the dead cells will appear blue. Occasionally, you will see artifacts, objects or debris that appear blurry and don't have a well-defined shape. This is an example of an artifact. We won't include it in our count. Proper storage, cleaning, and handling of the hemocytometer will minimize the number of artifacts. There are 10 viable cells and 1 non-viable cell in the first square. Now, the top right square. There are 9 viable cells and no non-viable cells. Next, let's count the bottom right square. There are 11 viable cells and no non-viable cells. And now the bottom left square. There are 10 viable cells and 2 non-viable cells. And finally, let's count the cells in the center square. Sometimes cells will appear as clumps or small groups. It may be difficult to determine exactly how many cells are in a group. The method of counting clumps of cells differs from lab to lab, so be sure to follow the procedure in your lab. We will count this clump as two cells. There are 14 viable cells and no non-viable cells in the center square. The total number of viable or living cells from all five squares is 54. The total number of non-viable cells is 3. Now that we have counted our cells, there are several calculations we need to perform. First, let's calculate the percentage of viable cells. Here's the formula. 54 viable cells divided by 57, the total number of cells, gives us 0.947. Multiply by 100, and the percentage of viable cells is 94.7%. Next, let's determine the average number of cells per square. We counted 54 viable cells. We divide 54 by 5 because we counted in 5 squares. The average number of cells per square is 10.8 cells. Now, let's calculate the dilution factor. The dilution equals the final volume divided by the volume of cells. Our final volume is 200 microliters because we started with 100 microliters of cells and added another 100 microliters of Tri-Pan Blue. 200 divided by 100 is 2. Therefore, the dilution factor is 2. Next, we need to calculate the concentration of viable cells, the number of living cells per milliliter. Our average count per square is 10.8. The dilution factor is 2. 10.8 times 2 times 10 to the fourth power equals 216,000 cells per milliliter. We can write the concentration using scientific notation as 2.16 times 10 to the fifth power cells per milliliter. From our calculations, we now know the concentration of cells in our culture is 216,000 cells per milliliter and approximately 94.7% are viable living cells.
Here, Tri-Pan Blue, not only for this lymphocytes, generally we use Tri-Pan Blue for viability of microbes also. Generally, membrane oxidase in living organism, membrane oxidases are there. This membrane oxidases will decolorize. Oxidation state of Tri-Pan Blue, not only Tri-Pan Blue, methylene blue also can be used here. That will be decolorized. And so we'll be differentiating yeast or other organisms whenever you are looking, even bacterial cells also, whenever we are looking for the viability, when you do the heat treatment or some chemical treatment, their viability will be checked with the Tri-Pan Blue or methylene blue. That is based on the membrane-based oxidases. When the oxygen moiety is added over there, that will be decolorized. You must have seen methylene blue case. So now we got lymphocytes, immunocells, immunological cells in your hand, and you have counted how many of them are live. Then we can use it for various applications. So one of the application is cytotoxicity. Whether the cells are like whatever the substances are there, they are toxicant or not. So just we'll do. And then after this experiment, Comet assay, we will be having all antigen antibody reactions. The time is upping. Just experiment part, I will explain the principle and the other thing is. Yeah, Comet assay. Comet assay is useful for detection of the DNA damage or genotoxicity. Generally, cells are overlaid in are wrapped in between the agarose layers, and it is digested with alkaline, and DNA is unwinded with alkaline conditions, and it is electrophoresed. And after electrophoresis, if the DNA is more damaged, if the DNA fragmented, then what happened? It will, if the smaller fragments are there, they will be migrating more. So you'll be able to see like a comet. Comet, you'll be see the head region and tail region. And more the tail region, then it will be the indication that more DNA genotoxicity or more DNA damage has occurred. So we'll see the experiment part in this one. Whatever the lymphocyte isolated in earlier experiment, we'll be using it for our comet assay experiment. That is the chemicals required for the experiment is concerned. Phosphate buffer serine, normal melting agarose, low melting agarose, normal chemicals for buffer. 3D bromide is required, slides, cover slips, and all the things. Electrophoretic chamber is required. Lysis buffer, the compositions are given over there. It is a TNA basically. Electrophoresis buffer, here not TIE buffer we'll be using. It is NaOH EDT buffer. This one, NaOH EDT buffer, TRIS NaOH buffer we'll be using. And for dehydration we'll be using, there's a 70% or 80%. And neutralization buffer we'll be using, that is a TRIS HCl of pH 7.5. Let's start the experiment. We'll be melting normal melting agarose, that normal we do for the electrophoresis. We'll be taking and we'll be preparing 1% agarose gel, agarose preparation that we'll be doing. And take it in 1 gram if you are taking, if you are 1%, if you are preparing, that is 100 ml. But we can do with smaller scales also if you are doing at small scale. So 100 ml is added to 1 gram of agarose. Agar also, this is agar is being used, agarose also can be used. Agar will give you good clarity of comet. After melting, see, it is the indication that if the clear suspension, clear water, if it gets, then it will be a completely dissolved. Now you take the slide and you do pre-coating of agar. So dip it for a while, just 15-20 seconds, and take it out. Yeah, sorry. Is it audible? Devendra, respond.
It's audible, sir.
Okay, thank you. So, after coating, drying, we'll be taking out. It is the time to deposit the cells. Actually, depositing of the cells, you will be preparing the suspension of low melting agarose. You will be preparing the low melting agar. Like here, we prepared normal agar. But it is advisable to prepare low melting, easily it gets liquefied. and lymphocytes which were isolated in earlier experiment, we'll take those things and with the low agarose, and for our convenient we have added ethidium bromide here itself. You can add ethidium bromide complete after the electrophoresis, you can add later phase also, and we are keeping a cover slip, a bigger cover slip, so that uniform layer will be formed. At the base you are having the agarose layer, agar layer, because in I'm using agarose, that's what I'm using, just the word agarose, but you can do with agar agar also. So whatever the cover slip that you have kept, you try to remove from there, and after gently removing the cover slip, you keep it for the lysis. Lysis solution is nothing but NaOH and EDTA. That composition has been given in this presentation anyhow. So don't do for a very long period this lysis, very short period, because lymphocytes are very sensitive. Easily they get sliced, and after once they are lysed, you need to make your DNA unwind it, and unwinding and electrophoresis both can be done simultaneously. If you can use NaOH and EDTA solution for running of electrophoresis, there will be both the activities. Otherwise, if you have a hair dryer kind of thing, if you can do the heat air supply, then that also will be unwinding will be completed. But if you do the more unwinding here, the problem is if alkali plus heat, these two are combined for the unwinding process, DNA will be very much fragmented. To prevent that one, generally we do this electrophoresis at low temperature. Generally cold rooms are available. In cold rooms we'll do this Comet assays. In this particular setup, see the buffer sodium hydroxide and EDTA buffer is being powered, and this setup is in a small refrigerator hood. Now the power pack has been connected, and we'll do the electrophoresis. If you don't have this facility, you can do even at normal, but it is better if you can have, if you can keep some ice packs nearby to your electrophoresis chamber. Otherwise, you can add the cool buffer. Here we'll be doing it low voltage. See, this is completed. Electrophoresis has been completed. Now we'll take it out. And after taking it out, first you need to do the neutralization, because you have used NaOH, strong NaOH, so the pH will be very alkaline in condition. So you need to neutralize, for which we'll be using Tris buffer of pH 7. After this is the neutralization phase. Then you need to make dehydration of that one. Whatever the residual water is there on the slide, and that should be removed. So if you have not added ethidium bromide in earlier phase, you can do after this phase, you can do the ethidium bromide thing. Otherwise, if you did already ethidium bromide, nowadays people are doing ethidium bromide staining in the beginning step itself. So you need not to do that part. Now you can observe under the gel dock or fluorescent microscope or normal UV transilluminator. I'll show you the image, how the comets will appear, just for your... So this is the head and tail region, how they will appear. We measure more the tail that has been migrated, that indicates your substance that you are checking is more genotoxic. This is generally, and even for the autoimmune disorders, to evaluate autoimmune disorders also we'll be using this Comet SS. So in softwares, by using the softwares, we'll be measuring the tail size and the head size. So the head, if the head size is reduced, see, this is a calculation strategy is concerned. Okay, with this one, I conclude the cell, immunological cells isolation and their applications is concerned.